Like children. As soon as they're next to each other, we have to separate these two. It's bad.
It's great.
It's really bad.
Hello, Nickelback. How are you guys?
Good.
Good.
Welcome to the West Midlands. Obviously, this is the birthplace of heavy metal with Black Sabbath, half of Led Zeppelin. Did you listen to these bands when you were
Can you say their names again? Who?
Black Sabbath.
Oh, never heard of them. No, of course.
They had a small career.
Is this like a new indie thing that's kind of coming
Yeah,
on?
Yeah. Led Zeppelin,
what is
if you heard of them.
Thing that you're speaking of?
Did you ever listen to them?
Daily.
Daily.
Hourly. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
How does it feel to be here in the UK?
It's great. Most of our schedules have already turned around. I mean, we've been here for 48 hours. Daniel's struggling a little bit. Didn't get a lot of sleep last night, but it'll come back around. And look at that. I see blue.
Yeah, there's a little bit of blue sky.
I see blue. The sun hostage over here, I think.
Don't people in the UK stop working completely and then walk outside if they see the sun just to get
a little bit of... Yeah, we had a tiny heat wave last week and everybody just went crazy.
That's great.
What is a heat wave here? Somebody said it's a heat wave. How hot is that?
Plus five.
It was about 20 degrees.
Was it really?
No, it was about 25.
Oh, that's nice. That's hot.
Which for us in April was like a miracle.
Half the population melted.
Yeah. Everybody just stripped down and everybody was outside.
Sure.
So how does it feel to do these small gigs compared to the big arena gigs?
We're not really playing a gig here. This is just a wonderful rehearsal studio. There's one like this in Pennsylvania in a town called Lititz, which is Amish country. So you look around the countryside and it's all still, you know, a lot of horse and buggy. Because, you know, obviously the Amish don't believe in using powered vehicles or anything like that. And then there's this large, how many stories is it? Six, eight stories? It's massive black box of a building. There's just nothing there. It just looks like a cube.
It's the Borg.
The Borg has landed and just like right into a field and it stops there. And then you walk in and you see that like U2 has used it. I mean, they rehearse for that big massive tour that they did
with all tour.
Yeah, and now there's, you know, one of these facilities here where no one really knows what goes on here, and it's just kind of in the middle
of
nowhere
weird,
and there's this box of a building
here,
and lots of trucks outside.
The Amish call that place the Black.
The Black?
It's not a compliment, they hate it.
So you get stuck in traffic behind the horses with all your trucks.
Yeah,
and...
sure.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, no, we take our gear in by a horse and
we try to blend in immediately.
Yeah, be part of the culture.
Get the Clydesdales pulling the.
And then after the gig, do you sort of chill out, or do you have a party or?
Party and party.
I think it just kind of depends on if there's a day off. If you got a day off, we tend to go a little harder, you know. And if you've got 2 days off, you go really hard, you know. If you're doing two in a row, you try and be on your best behavior. If it's a school night, as we call it, you know, a little bit.
Yeah.
But not too debaucherous.
Just like everybody else, you don't have to work tomorrow.
Exactly.
Yeah. You abuse yourself.
Yeah.
Yeah, we forgot about this. Let's use the microphones. So the album which came out last year, how are you feeling that's going? Is everybody really enjoying the new songs? And because I played Home today on my show, your new single.
We should probably learn how to play that. Should we learn how to play Home?
Again, yeah, maybe, again. The reception's been great. I'm really happy with how it turned out too.
Yeah, because it's a bit heavier than more recent albums and you've sort of gone back to your early days. Was there a reason for that?
Just felt like it.
Yeah, just felt right. We don't know what we're doing. I don't know if you know that. We just start.
Yeah.
We just start, and then stop at some point, and then you find out if there's any kind of connection with the songs. This just felt like there was lots of rock that was coming out. Just
management felt shows right. up. The record company shows up, and they're like, "That's good. You can stop now." And we're like, "Okay, we're done." And then it's like,
"Did you just
okay,
say
now
we start at some point and then we end at some point?"
Yeah.
It's revolutionary stuff.
Well, we start at some point, and then we stop at some point.
Neil deGrasse Tyson shit. Right,
you can take that and run with that, but give me credit for it.
Thank you.
I need some time with that quote.
Rockstar was a song that exploded here in the UK. Is it true that you had to sort of stop what you were doing? You were working on an album to come here and go on tour, like, because we were so in love with this song.
Well, you guys passed over the other six singles on that album that worked everywhere else in the world except the UK, and you guys just weren't having it. So we're like, okay, well, we're pretty much done in the UK.
We're finished.
Yeah, we're like, okay.
Stop carrying the record.
Really?
Goodbye. Oh, yeah. Goodbye, Wembley. We won't be seeing you anymore, and the O2, and, you know, all the other places that we like to stop in the UK, and we're just like, nah, we will never be going back there, because you literally just went over every single single and just weren't interested. Rockstar comes along.
What happened with that? When Rockstar came along, something about it was banned.
The Billboard.
Yeah, there was a Billboard.
Yeah, it was banned. Yeah.
We love it here if something's banned.
I think that's why it popped. They're like, Yeah, oh, we can't listen to it? Well, we're going to listen to it then. That's why we're going to listen to it.
Mommy doesn't like it. I like it.
Same thing happened with Frankie Goes to Hollywood with Relax. Yeah, exactly. They did the same thing. Banned in the UK. And then it was like, we have to hear this.
It was number one.
No.
Alice Cooper did the same thing.
And we did book a tour around that, specifically for the UK because of that. And we were in the studio with Mutt doing Dark Horse. And did we finished it first? Like, we just finished
no,
it?
No.
There was about a month left that they still had to do.
You had to sort of just stop what you were doing and get
out
of
here. And go there.
He went
and
back
come
to
back,
Switzerland,
and stuff.
And then
yeah.
we came over here right. and just did it. I think we just did a UK leg that was completely, I mean, it sold out in like minutes just because you weren't allowed to hear the song.
And then all of a sudden, we're going to listen to this song.
We're going to hear it anyway.
Do you know the story of the billboard?
Go on, tell us.
It was all made up.
The whole thing's made up.
There was no billboard. There was nothing banned. Nothing happened.
I thought it was
all
made up. Sort of saying,
the whole thing is just a made up story.
Yeah. So there was not even a poster?
No.
No.
Who started the rumor?
One of the guys from our record company.
No, it was a publicist that we had. Yeah. Was it that Christian guy came up with that one?
I think it was Michelle.
Was it Michelle Kerr?
I think so.
Genius move.
So, Feed the Machine has been banned from UK. I don't know if you heard of it.
Yeah. It's a shame.
As well as every single that we are going to release for the rest of our careers. Yeah. It will be banned.
They just won't play it here because it's banned. Nope.
I won't play home tomorrow.
Very risky.
No,
it's been banned.
Not allowed.
Banned.
Yep. Where do you guys think you're going to be, you know, in 5 years' time, or what are you going to do after this tour? What are your plans for the future?
We haven't really gotten that far. I'm sure at some point in time, someone's going to pressure us to go make another album, and we'll probably do that. And, you know, we'll just kind of just keep doing what we're doing. I mean, we're just having fun. There's no pressure. You know, this is a great part of our career because we don't have to go on press tours and we don't have to get up at 6 o'clock in the morning and show up with our acoustic guitars, you know, at radio stations and beg people to play our music. Like,
we don't want to sell records anymore. Well, really. We
don't have to do any of that stuff anymore.
Tickets or records anymore.
Yeah, that's old. It's great. Now we just kind of get up in the middle of the afternoon, show up to the arena whenever you want to, and then, you know, go to catering, have something to eat, warm up a little bit, get on stage, sing our songs, and then it's rinse and repeat. We go to the next city and just, you know, and just have fun. Yeah. And you'll notice, like, now on stage, you know, the banter is it's pretty relaxed and it's chill. And Ryan and I just, you know, usually just pick on Mike.
Make it up as we go along. Yeah.
Make it up as we go along. Yeah. But it's just, you know, relaxed but we get it, you know, cause we've seen so many shows ourselves. And I recently went and saw Billy Joel. Just what a show. Mm-hmm. Amazing. Fantastic. Like, he's just so like, that stage is like his living room. And the way he talks to the audience, and he's just got everybody laughing their ass off. And when you see that, and when you feel that comfortability, you become comfortable. You notice when you watch somebody on stage and you can tell they're nervous, and then suddenly you feel like uncomfortable?
Yeah, it's a bit awkward.
It's like, you know, but when someone's just really relaxed and they're just, then suddenly you're relaxed.
Wasn't one of your first gigs where you couldn't make it? You had to improvise.
That's right. Well, that was a long, long time ago. Daniel wasn't in the band at that time. But
what's that?
When Mitch couldn't make it to the gig. I wonder if that's what you're talking about. Are you talking about the drummer didn't make it?
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah,
oh.
we were that
oh,
was
actually,
a long time
actually, we're going back
time
to the
ago.
90s here.
Oh, yeah,
we were
97 or something.
We were doing an in-store CD store. CDs were things that you actually put in a CD player.
Put them in a CD
music
player.
On them.
Yeah.
And then you'd have to buy them. It was something you held in your hand.
So as far as forms of music format go, starts off as a vinyl.
Yeah.
And then it moves into 8-track. And then it goes to cassette tape.
Tape.
Then CD. Now it's free.
But even the CD player, you'd have to pull it out of your car and carry it with you when you went to the restaurant.
Yeah.
Or you could get one to just the front.
Or you could just with the front. Yeah, that was further in the future.
Yeah.
That's a bad neighborhood.
We did an in-store at this record store. And yeah, our drummer, he was from the Vancouver Island. We're playing Vancouver.
Yeah.
Missed a ferry or something. I don't know.
That's right.
Couldn't make it. We're like, so Chad hops on the drums.
I had to play drums and sing.
I'm playing all the guitar parts. I'm playing bass. And we're just like, we are now Rush. Except not near as good.
Well, I hope you guys have a wonderful time here in the UK. The first one's in Glasgow. And thank you for coming to do this exclusive session for Absolute Radio listeners. Nice to meet you guys.
Nice to meet you. Thank you so much. Thanks for having us.
I hope you can use some of this.
There's got to be 2 out of the 10 minutes. It's good.